my clock on my calendar here. So I'm going to go ahead and kick us off today for the roundtable discussion on ChatGPT. So good day, everybody. Today, we're gathered to discuss the topic of ChatGPT and AI tools in higher education, because we're broadening the scope a little bit, clearly beyond just this one, which seems to be kind of a generator tool. As we all know, technology is rapidly changing the landscape of education, and AI tools are becoming increasingly prevalent in classrooms, online courses, and other educational resources. These tools have the potential to revolutionize the way that we teach and learn, but they also raise some important questions about the role of technology in education, its limitations and benefits, and ethical implications of relying on these tools, doing academic work, or maybe even our own work. Therefore, it's important for us to have a thoughtful and informed discussion about these issues to better understand the potential of these AI tools in higher education and how we can use them to enhance the learning experience, ensuring that we always prioritize student learning outcomes and ethical considerations. That statement is brought to you by ChatGPT. So it's my honor to introduce our facilitator for this awesome roundtable discussion today, which is Christala Smith, the director for the Center of Instructional Design and Technology at Southeastern Oklahoma State University, and also our current chair of the Council for Online Learning Excellence. So Christala, I'll go ahead and turn it over to you, and I'll be here to answer any questions or provide assistance that you all may need along the way.
Thank you, Brad. I absolutely love it that you used ChatGPT to write the intro to this session. That's awesome.
I mean, why not?
Perfect. So everyone, this is a roundtable. So this is not me telling you about ChatGPT. This is a discussion. And like Brad mentioned, ChatGPT is a catch-all for several AI tools. Really, this is about generative AI in education. So we're going to have, let me kind of establish the ground rules, and then we will really get going. But in the chat, I'm going to post it again for those of you that are just coming in. We have a Jamboard, and I will share my screen in just a minute. But everyone can actually participate either by speaking, unmuting and talking, or by using the Jamboard. This is such a hot topic, I know, and it's impossible to get everything said that everyone is thinking within an hour. So if you can't get your comment in, or if your comment is a little longer or you want to go a little bit farther, that's what the Jamboard is for. So the Jamboard will also be something that we can keep and continue after. And we also have a new committee at the state level that will be discussing ChatGPT, and I'm looking forward to even having some of the feedback from this session then too. But a couple of reminders. First, please be positive. This is not a venting or a fearful type session. Remember, the name of this conference is the Learning Innovations Summit. So we're talking about how to use technologies in an innovative way. Second, be respectful. I know everyone has different views, different concerns. We want to collaborate and come up with solutions where possible, or at least acknowledge the concerns that we have, but do so in a respectful way. So the first thing that we're going to do is look at the Jamboard. And some of you may not have used a Jamboard before. So this is a Google Suite product. And in a Jamboard, everyone can collaborate and communicate. I have slides through here. There's 9. You can go through there and see what they are. In this session, I am fine with jumping around. We do not have to have a linear discussion. So I'm going to preview really quick what the different topics with the subtopics are. But if you really feel passionate about one of these, you don't have to wait. You can go ahead and start adding sticky notes where you would like. So in a Jamboard, you have some tools over here. The one that I really would prefer you use is the sticky note, which is right here, sorry. So the sticky note, when you click on that, you can add any kind of comment. And then it's going to put it on the screen for everyone. You can move it around. So there's already an example one here. So any of you can click on that sticky note and add whatever comment you would like. So this first one's really just a title slide. The subtopics are innovation. What are good things that we can do with this? Ethics, what concerns should be addressed? classroom application, what are the possibilities? And classroom application, the challenges and solutions. And I would love to see, you know, some solutions to the challenges as they're posted. Workforce application, and specifically the role of higher education in that conversation. Responsible use, how do we use it or teach others to use it appropriately? Equity, are there concerns when it comes to the digital divide and having access to this? And this last one is other. What would you like to say that there didn't seem to be a place for? So this can be anything else. Now, if something is super popular and we need to add more space because it is full of sticky notes, we can absolutely do that. Brad or I, or technically any of you, can come in and click the three dots in here and duplicate the slide. And then we can just keep running with that one. If you want to see kind of a quick view of the slides so you can jump around or remember what the subtopics were, you can click on the slides up here. So you can move back and forth with the arrows left and right. You can also click to see the slides, and you can still navigate through this way. This is the last slide. So if you hit the arrow to move over after that, it'll just add more slides, which is fine, but there's nothing after that. So for our conversation out loud while we're going, we're just going to kind of start with the first slide, which is innovation, and we'll talk about some things that we can do with it. But as the conversation progresses, you're welcome to help lead. You're welcome to help take us back or jump ahead. Anything is fine. So I'm going to open it up at this point and ask you for some ideas on the first topic, which is innovation. What are some good things that we can do with generative AI? Who wants to start us off? Everyone is exploring the Jamboard.
Christala, did you say it's okay to also talk?
Yes, that's what I want okay. Right now.
Got it.
The Jamboard is supplemental so that we can get in as much as possible.
Okay. I think... some good things that we can do with the with these large language models and AI tools is use them as a brainstorming tool. And I've been in some committee meetings where that technique has been used pretty successfully.
All right, perfect. You know, I was looking at that from, I teach comp. And so of course, when it comes to writing, that's definitely one of the concerns. However, for the brainstorming side, it is great. For example, you can ask it to make an outline for an essay on a certain topic, and you can ask for the same topic outline multiple times and get different results. And a lot of students struggle to come up with the subtopics that would fall under a category to write about. That would be a great way to get some help in the brainstorming phase. Any other ideas? Everyone typing?
I use it to help draft a lot of correspondence to students, like those emails that would take me normally like 5 or 6 minutes. I put it in ChatGPT, and while it's generating, I'm responding to like two other emails.
Nice. And Brad uses it to write intros to sessions, so we know that works too.
Brad uses it in a lot of ways.
Right now I'm troubleshooting with it on getting it to write HTML code for implementation into the LMS, like on some of our pages, to make them a little more visually interesting. So that's my current challenge, but you know, garbage in, garbage out. So right now my HTML is kind of garbage, so it's only giving me a little bit rough HTML. That's how I've been reteaching myself HTML by using ChatGPT.
Brad, this is an interesting one. Someone put rubrics. What was that?
Brad, do you have the paid version or the free version?
I actually have the free version. I have not upgraded to the paid version.
Yeah, I haven't either. And I don't really know what the difference is. I've just used the free version. I've heard from some people who say that the paid version has less lag time, but I don't know if there's any functional difference between the two.
I'm not sure that there really is, Simon. I think it's just priority access to their servers. Sometimes with the paid version, I'll have to go and refresh the page about 3 or 4 times maybe to get it to load because it's maxed out. But if you do that, I've never waited longer than 5 minutes to get in. So I think that may be one of the key factors there. Does anybody else know, though, in the audience? I'm curious, those of you that have played with it.
The paid version only gives you access to 3, or the free version only gives you access to 3.5. With 4.0, you can access, with the paid version, you can access 3.5, 3.5 Classic, and 4.0. 4.0 has a larger LLM, something on the order of several trillion documents as opposed to several billion documents. So it's at least an order of magnitude larger database. Plus you have access to citations in addition to a shorter queue time the queue time difference is negligible.
Great. Thank you, Michael.
Yeah, I appreciate that.
I've had issues with citations in the past, so I wonder if the new 4 is better with the citations being more accurate.
Not in my area of subject matter expertise, but that's because of the access to the databases. I teach law, so there's at least one of the 4 major players in legal research that has incorporated ChatGPT technology into their research platform and given it access to their databases. And that's a game changer.
Great.
It's the most profound revolution in legal research since the advent of electronic legal research and prior to that, the printing press.
So, Michael, this is Kathy. The database, is that usually a paywall database, the one that ChatGPT has access to now?
No, it's a question of labor hour programming. They stopped programming the databases for 3.5 last November, and then they started working on 4.0 in addition to the upgrades in the interface, which, again, you know, the end user has a hard time distinguishing between the two. But the results tend to be a little bit more accurate. Less of the hallucinations, but there's still, you know, quite a few hallucinations out there in terms of the feedback that you get from the AI bot.
Crystal, I want to make sure to point out some of these comments in the chat here. Like Kathy said, reading some conversations may have access to resources beyond the paywalls. Jay said from UCO that the paid version presents an issue with their purchasing procurement rules related to security standards, which I think is kind of curious. And Simon dropped a link in the chat to an article discussing inside the secret list of websites that make AI like ChatGPT sound smart. Doesn't mean they are smart, makes them sound smart.
That's Washington Post wrote that headline, not me. I don't know if I like that headline. Yeah, I don't know if I like that headline too much, but that's theirs, not mine.
I'll throw out there that I've been using it to generate content regarding our projects at the state region. So for Upskill OK, the micro-credentialing initiative, I've copied numerous articles into it, you know, that we've had written, paragraph statistics, and have asked it to generate, you know, questions, value statements. I ended up creating a rubric for micro-credential programs based upon the priorities that we had written about in an article that was very distinct. So it is as good and can be as good as what you put into it, but again, presents some major issues along the way.
I'm curious if anybody's teaching students yet how to use ChatGPT as opposed to just, you know, using it to help assist in andragogical tasks. Because that's where I'm going to have to go.
Yeah, I'm not personally, but I'm working with somebody at UCO, Laura Duman. I think she's presenting, so she may not be on the call right this second. But she is actually teaches technical writing and does do the whole teaching students how to use it and using it in appropriate ways. Like she'll talk to them about like how to use it for brainstorming or how would you use it for writing an outline. And then they have been sharing back with her like their results and, oh, well, I used it here to do this. She's really big on transparency. So one of her things is if you use it, fine, but I want you to tell me how you're using it and at what point in this process you used it. And so she's got some really great resources for how she's been talking to her students about using it on their side of the house.
That's good to know that, it's out there. Somebody's using it. I had used it. I also will pick up a philosophy section here or there. And I've used it in 3.5. Submitted a question to the model, pasted the answer into an assignment and asked students to indicate where the model was wrong, because it was wrong. It was quite technically inaccurate. And I found that useful, I think there's a narrow window of time where that will work as it gets access to greater databases and as the programming's and competitors come online and the programming's improved. I don't know if that will be a successful model for very long.
I think just earlier this week, we had someone, I think it was Mr. Chuck, talking about using it in his classes too. He has a section on AI anyway, so he talked to his students about it. And I even think that I would be pretty comfortable talking to my students because I would rather them know that I know what it is than for them to think that I might not and see and test the waters. I would rather them use it in responsible ways, which is what this slide is on. So be thinking, not how do we hope students don't find out about it, because that's not realistic, but instead, how do we teach them to use it appropriately? What thoughts do you have about that?
That's going to be very discipline specific, isn't it?
Sure.
So, the concerns that a composition teacher has is going to be entirely different from, someone in my subject matter area or someone teaching nursing, et cetera. For me, it's a tool that they have to learn how to use in order to discharge their obligations. Composition, as you hear me fumble around with the English language, obviously I don't know enough about communicating well to have an informed opinion about whether and how to use this in teaching communication and composition of any sort.
So I think when I teach my students about writing, it's also a lot about critical thinking though. And I teach them about how to ask why questions to get deeper and deeper into the subject. And that's something interesting about ChatGPT, that it can definitely help you dive a little deeper with the interactive, actual conversational type experience that you can have with it. But what's interesting is that I've always taught this as, very philosophically, that they need to ask these questions, but this would actually give them practice. They can actually test out what kind of answer their question would get, and they can get better at asking questions. So, right now we are used to just typing anything into Google and just searching through what is there. We don't have to be good at asking questions. Maybe this is an opportunity to learn how to better ask questions to get the results that we want. Just a thought there. Other ideas? Someone put the dilemma, where does the line fall of needing to share that AI was partially used to generate content? And we've talked about that in several cold meetings that I've been in too, where, you can ask your students to identify, did you use this for brainstorming, for creating, for editing? What exactly did you use it for? Instead of saying, did you use it, but how did you use it? in my mind, that almost has to be an open-ended question because the ways to use it, the list is getting too long. Other thoughts? Let's see. Oh, we have a comment over here. So one aspect of this is that in higher ed, we know that we're preparing them for a future in some career. They're going to use the skills in our classroom, whether technical skills or critical thinking skills, they're going to use what they're learning in higher ed to apply that in the workforce in some way. What then is our responsibility in higher ed, not just to think about our classroom, but the bigger picture of how they might use this later? For example, they may go into a job where they're expected to know how to use technology like this for the sake of efficiency. So is saying don't use this going to benefit them in the long run? Maybe. Or is it more important to recognize that the workforce might have some type of demand for it?
I teach marketing classes, and I think it'll be almost impossible for my students to get jobs if they don't understand the marketing implications of these tools. There's graphic AI, there's video AI, there's voiceover AI, there's social media AI, there's sales AI. Like, they're going to have to know that all those tools exist and be able to use them, or at least be capable of figuring out how to use them.
Right.
So I don't think this is something I can quietly sit on the sidelines for. I think marketing is going to be up front, especially in higher ed.
Right. I think that's a great example.
Yeah, I do voiceovers myself, so you can hear the, you know, what I'm saying and how I'm saying it. And I've actually listened to some of those voiceover AIs, and they are not as warm and as loving as my voice is. I can tell you that.
I think that's absolutely true, but they are even so much better than they were 6 months ago. Like, I demoed one in class the other day where they created an AI that was just exactly like the person that was talking about it. And then this AI can talk in 40 languages, and it's not perfect, but wow, it is incredibly close.
I've been impressed with some of those too. My husband actually uses some of those in his work. They've been able to, in trainings, they've recorded enough of their voices of some of their staff that they can apply in those. It's pretty interesting.
In my discipline, students will have to learn how to use it. It's so disruptive that if I were teaching in a law school or the dean of a law school right now, I'd be I'd be deeply worried. The efficiencies will change are changing the very business model of how law firms work.
A lot of my students are really worried about it too. They spent four years learning how to Adobe Suite. Now here's AI that can just do it. But part of what I keep telling them, though, is, you know, the birth rate since the recession is down 20%. And so there's truly not going to be enough humans to do it how we used to do it. And so I keep teasing them, do not worry, you are highly employable, but just realize that some of your coworkers will probably be AI software. And that's just what it is. That's what the world looks like now.
Interesting perspective.
I just want to make a quick note that it's been discussed, especially in the instructional design industry, that's one area that we have to be definitely watching out for because of the way ChatGPT can be used to create a lot of the things that instructional designers do. And so instructional designers are actually very worried. There was a big article about this in the instructional designers newsletter that I subscribe to.
I understand the worry, but just the fact that Gen Z is so small and Gen Alpha is on track to be even smaller, I think that in a lot of ways, all this is really going to do is make up for the fact that there aren't enough people to do all the jobs that exist.
It can be hard to think that far forward, right? We're very much concerned about the immediate impact, but you know, we also want our students to be forward thinking. We want them to think of the long term. We have to do the same.
I'm also, you know, to Laura's point regarding the notion of what instructional designers do for a course, I think about applying alignment to an online course and how beneficial it could potentially be to have the assistance of AI in making suggestions, you know, for alignment of courses, you know, instructional materials, learning activities, tools being used. I think there's a lot of opportunity to maybe explore. And that title of the article, you know, Laura shared too, is that mediocrity is over. And I think that that kind of speaks to that kind of potential, is that it could really make this a different approach, but one that I think still will require some kind of human involvement because we're still teaching humans. I see Amanda has her hand raised.
Sorry, I was just thinking as you were as you guys were all talking about the instructional design process and instructional designers, and I think one of the things that occurred to me is how long sometimes it can take for a human to go through the instructional design process, and how long it can take to actually create some of those materials, and how that sometimes is a barrier for instructors in updating material, updating content in their courses, because of the length of time it takes. You don't want to update it every semester if you don't have to, just because there's so much involved. But this might be a way for instructors and instructional designers maybe to speed up that process and keep things more up to date than maybe they could in the past, because you've got that assistance there that you didn't have before. Just something I was thinking, it might help us be able to be a little bit more current in some of these industries.
Doesn't that dovetail right into OER? In that, with OER, essentially what we're trying to do is release the grip of near monopoly that a few of the textbook publishers have on instructional design, especially in the online components. I've resisted writing an OER for lack of time for years, but as I look at my calendar and see that I've got some time coming up, I'm going to use ChatGPT to help me design a course from scratch, including the educational resources. It, in fact, democratizes instructional design.
I think to build on that, one of the challenges that we often see with faculty developing courses is creating forms of assessment, especially if they use exams in their courses, in moving beyond those basic levels of Bloom's taxonomy. So being able to put a question in and have it developed from the understanding level, perhaps up to a synthesis level, would be a huge time saver as a faculty member.
I concur, because that's really all I use the online resources provided by publishers for, is just low level understanding, and then, you know, design. I'm already designing. I've designed my own curriculum for years to take it beyond that.
One thing that I think would be a good use of this, it's really difficult to create branching scenarios because you're having to flesh out every single branch, you know, and I really think if you set the basic parameters up and then had ChatGPT run with it, because I was actually thinking about having it be the dungeon master for a D&D thing. I think it would be really good at that too, but it's not so very different though, right? Branching scenarios as you're fleshing them out, you know, in storyline or whatever content production tool you're using. I think it'd be really useful. That takes so much time, and to just think of all the different things, that would be a big load off.
Yeah, I thought the same thing with D&D. Finally, after 45 years of playing D&D, I can experience a TPK because the AI will not have any concerns at all for how I feel about my character dying.
No bias. Well, that's not true. It does have bias, but you know what I mean. It doesn't care whether you are sad about it.
Oh, there were some comments over here on ethics. Elon Musk say that if there is not a governing body for AI, that AI could take over the world. And copyright concerns, original works or derivative works, thoughts about ethics.
There are in the courts presently a fair amount of litigation working out the details as to how the law is going to come down on copyright. It's still up in the air, and it'll take a few years for that for the dust to settle. If I had to predict, simply because the law is so conservative, it's likely going to, well, I can't predict. I mean, it's just a different creature altogether, because if, you know, copyright belongs to the creator, but who is the creator? The creator is not AI, but the team that put the AI together and the database and the prompt writer. It's a collaborative effort that takes, you know, it's taken dozens of years, billions of dollars, and hundreds of people to get to this stage.
Where do you see this applying to the DMCA? That's the Digital Millennium Copyright Act.
Well, I think the DMCA is inadequate to deal with it. The European Union had a new update to their version of DMCA and then scrapped it last November when they realized what was coming online. I think if you want to follow where it's likely to go, you should follow the EU's equivalent. And they're, because of the nature of civil law versus common law, likely to be ahead of the curve in figuring that out.
Well, as of right now, isn't anything created by any of these AIs, isn't that now, you know, according to current law, not expected law, but current law, current judicial decisions, isn't that now considered not necessarily an original work, but a derivative work?
Yes.
That's kind of what I thought, but, you know, when I am asked that at my institution, that's my response so far. That is definitely subject to change, though.
Yes. Yeah, and the legal scholarship on derivative work is vague enough to cause concern, because you start to get into, you know, essentially contribution calculations. How much of this derivative work is original content and how much isn't? The safest thing to do in the meantime is just to require disclosures and pay careful attention to the end user license agreement from whatever AI model you're working with, because those are, you know, like any other user agreement, are subject to change without notice. And so if the copyright presently says we own everything that is generated by our AI, then you're in a difficult position. It doesn't say that, but at some point it will.
Well, how does that then apply directly to royalty fees and royalty stipends and what have you? Aren't we having fun now?
It will write songs. I mean, it'll write poetry.
Inject something into the conversation here. I've dropped a link into the chat to the U.S. Copyright Office's page on AI, and this conversation is still ongoing. There was actually yesterday a webinar that they held on literary works, including software packages or creations. And so the approach that it seems that they're taking is knowing that it needs to be revisited, that the current law does not really cover what we're dealing with, and they're conducting listening sessions. So May 2nd, they will have one that's on visual arts. May 17th, there will be one on audiovisual works. And then May 31st, they'll have one on music and sound recording. So these are listening sessions. These are not them presenting. It's people having an opportunity to make and submit comments and have discussions there. So I would highly encourage those of you that are in the legal world of this or just working as artists, even or creators in any of those areas, sit in and listen, see what they have to say. It looks like they're going to end up opening or issuing a notice of inquiry later on in this year after they summarize the findings. So
I'm going to be listening. I can tell you that.
Yeah, I bet. Yeah. Jay. Same here. But yeah, just wanted to share that with you all. And it looks like there are some other resources out there.
I always think it's interesting when they talk about AI taking over the world, and it might be just because I've gotten a little bit jaded, but you know, having lived through Y2K and some of those other dramatic things that didn't end up being dramatic things, it just seems like maybe we overreact rather than just calmly realizing that technology change is inevitable. Bad. I show a video in my class about Y2K, and they just look at me. Well, first I describe it, and they look at me like I totally made it up, and then I show them a two-minute video clip, and they're like, no way. But well, it is interesting that here we are again.
But, you know, bad news can always be a solid source of revenue generation.
Yeah, I wouldn't be surprised if a lot of why it picked up speed so fast was because of the concern itself. Everyone wanted to see exactly what this thing could do that was getting so much attention.
Maybe it's a misanthrope in me, but that's not too much of a concern on my part. It's not like humans have done a great job.
Let's see what we haven't covered too much yet. So we did a little bit with classes, that was kind of wrapped in challenges and solutions, a little workforce. Someone added a comment for responsible use about Quillbot. So there's software called Quillbot that will summarize what an AI writes for you and is impossible to detect that it was written by a human. Does anyone want to share a little bit more about Quillbot?
I thought Quillbot's accuracy was about 92%. I wouldn't use it to initiate a student dishonesty complaint. Because if I'm wrong 8% of the time, that's just too high, given the consequences of a student academic dishonesty complaint.
We haven't talked a lot about this one. I think this is an interesting piece of the conversation, is equity. So someone already did put a comment on here that says prioritize use of and training for open source models. Let's not get trapped in the Adobe model again. Would anyone like to elaborate on that, or any other comments regarding equity or concerns about students that may not have access, may be a little left behind in this area? Good to be left behind in this area? Will people be left behind in this area?
Can somebody explain what the Adobe model, what they mean by the Adobe model, other than, you know, daily updates?
I believe what they're talking about is how Adobe used to have a single purchase model and now they've moved to a subscription model.
No.
Is that it? Maybe they were thinking something else.
So
John, I think we're losing you.
Sorry, can you hear me now?
Yeah.
So the Adobe model is just that every university for most of their digital art stuff gets all the higher ed training is in Adobe. So you have like Illustrator, you have Photoshop, you have all these things, but it's made it to where students don't know how to work outside of Adobe. They don't know how to use video editing tools. They know how to use Adobe's video editing tools. And that does create a large barrier once you get outside the university where those products are extremely expensive and you're locked into their ecosystem. Whereas open source models, like, you know, they might not always be, you know, the right now they are the like bleeding edge of AI, but they might not always be that. But if we train around open source models, one, there's a lot more transparency there, which is important when it comes to machine learning models. But two, it helps keep the barrier of entry much lower than otherwise.
Thanks, Sean. I appreciate the clarification. That makes a lot of sense.
Yeah, I understand now. Thank you.
Yeah, and I agree. You know, we focus so much on Adobe tools, but there's plenty of opportunity outside of Adobe. Same thing here. You know, do we want to make sure that students have the ability to have the access? Michael, did you start to say something?
On the pricing model that was discussed previously, and this is just one example. It's the only one I know of from my discipline. Case Text will charge $50 per search or $500 a month per unlimited search. Using OpenAI's platform and their proprietary databases, which covers most of the enacted and case law on the planet, and all the way down to the city level. And that is, of course, exponentially cheaper than a junior associate right out of law school doing the same thing for 50 grand plus.
How would you compare the accuracy of those two options? A junior, I forget the terminology used, but a junior lawyer versus the AI as it exists right now?
Let me answer that with an anecdote. Our general counsel, who uses Case Text, sat down to play with it about 3 weeks ago. She said that among the questions I asked for a policy on a certain area of regulatory law. She told me what it was. It just went in one ear and out the other because I don't care. And because I would not have her job for twice what they pay her. But she said that the working group that had been working on the thing, the same policy for over a year, was only halfway done, and it gave her a perfectly good policy in about 15 seconds. And she checked all the citations to the enacted law, and they were all 100% accurate. That's just astounding. She said she actually pushed her chair back away from her desk and just sat there with her mouth agape for some time.
So, Michael, what I'm hearing you say is that in 5 to 10 years, all the weekly legal procedural dramas that my wife and I like to watch on TV are going to be very anachronistic.
No, there is still a need for one, the human interface in the courtroom. Although I think in the not too distant future, 10, 15 years from now, maybe even quicker than that, a fair amount of administrative or small claims types of problems can be handled using these technologies without the necessity of a lawyer being involved. But what you tend to see dramatized is the human interactions in courtrooms and depositions. Those will still have to be done because that's the gathering of the data and the argumentation related to abductive reasoning that the AI models are not going to be good at, probably for, I don't know, 10 or 15 more years until quantum computing and the requisite modal logics going are fully developed. So I don't expect it to show up in popular culture as to what the legal profession does, but it will mean that a junior associate coming out of, or a new graduate coming out of law school is going to have a hard time finding a job for 50, or if you're, you know, working for one of those law firms that essentially own you for a couple decades, $150,000, $200,000 a year, because it's just economically inefficient to use junior associates for those tasks. And that's what they're presently used for. And that's what they have been used for over a century, is the grunt work of legal research. It takes time and training to learn how to do that and then communicate that information even to another legal professional, let alone a layperson. These AI bots, because that is really, although it's a very complicated repetitive cognitive task, it's nothing more than a repetitive cognitive task.
That's interesting perspective. I appreciate that.
There's a thinker out of, well, actually a father and son team now, because the son followed the father, Robert Susskind out of Oxford, who's written about this for a couple decades. So if you want to kind of tap into some more serious thinker along these lines, that's somebody I would recommend. It's Susskind.
Michael, do you think that those initial, you talked about you're basically owned by a law firm for a couple years and you're doing some more mundane tasks, but do you think that's an essential part of the development of the person, or do you feel like that's just a consequence of cheaper hours?
It's a consequence of cheaper hours. Doing all of that work, it'll teach you a little bit more about the substantive law, but it doesn't necessarily make you a better lawyer. I mean, being a good lawyer is a lot more than doing good legal research. The human interaction, that takes time to learn, and you can then focus on that. And I think legal education will have to change accordingly, at least in law schools. Where it will change at the undergraduate level is I'm going to have to teach paralegals how to use ChatGPT or, AIs to do this legal research, because a senior partner or an older attorney, at least for another decade or so, as they're still dominated by baby boomers and Gen Xers, it's not going to take the time to learn this new tech. They don't have the time to learn this new tech. It's enough to keep up with the changes in the law. And while there's a comment to the rules of professional conduct that require an attorney to be competent as to the technology used in the profession, I don't think that the courts will punish somebody for doing something like delegating the task to a non-legal professional, because they haven't yet. Since in the 40 some odd years that we've had electronic legal research available.
If I had to pay a lawyer to do research and present my case, knowing that they could use ChatGPT, but because of that, they would be faster and I would therefore pay less?
Yes. Yes. And smart law firms are already starting to do that. They're one of the biggest firms on the planet, out of London, has started doing just that and advertising it to their clients, their customer base, that we can do the same work cheaper. It is not only faster, exponentially faster, but it's considerably more accurate. The human accuracy hovers somewhere around 92-95%. Just in, say, the review of documents. So, say you have a case with 50,000, 500,000 pages of documents. Searching through those has been done by primitive AIs for about a decade. And one of the more innovative players, a group out of Texas called Disco, has incorporated AI into their ChatGPT's AI, OpenAI's platform, into their research, their document review software, so that you can do plain language searches as opposed to using Boolean search terms. And search through 500,000 documents in a matter of seconds, getting hits on all the documents that fit the parameters of the question that you asked. So you could ask, you know, you look at the Enron database and how many emails went from this guy to that person regarding this subject.
So with this in mind, and with what you're saying with equity in the digital divide, what I'm hearing is this is going to be happening. The people who don't learn to use this are going to be at a disadvantage. They're going to need more time, which is going to cost more money, which is going to make them less hireable, which is going to be a huge financial divide because of the digital divide created. And that's one scenario that I think is probably representative of others if we really start thinking about all of those others. Would you agree?
Yes. Absolutely. Which is why I've been reading about this for the better part of 7 or 8 years, is knowing that it was coming. It still surprised me when it came. You know, the pandemic accelerated everything. And so, you know, now we're 15 years further down the road than I thought we would be in 2023.
And so that kind of goes back to this responsible use. It's not that we don't teach it, and it's not that we try to catch them using it, but we teach them why to use it and how to use it, because otherwise maybe we're contributing to the digital divide.
Correct. Yeah.
It's like, other thoughts on that? That anybody
fire with that? Fire burns. I don't like fire. It's new. But look at all the things fire can do.
Christala, much as I expected, we're running up on time for the end of our discussion for the meeting here. So we might go ahead and do last call for any comments or questions from the audience that they might like to share. Otherwise, we do have another round of sessions starting at 2:00 as well.
Flipping through here to see if there were any that I didn't catch before, or maybe to prompt you if there are areas you would like to touch on quickly again before we leave. It's been a good conversation though.
I feel like we need to schedule like a every other month roundtable on this, because it just evolved so fast. And we are staying on top of this in the Council for Online Learning Excellence as well. So rest assured, it's not being ignored.
Yep, hot topic in every arena, I think. But I do like this conversation, and I like where it went. And I like, you know, that we talked a lot about good uses, innovative uses. I know there's a lot of concerns, but those concerns shouldn't outweigh the innovations that can come from it. And, you know, the balance that we talked about a little bit about how in the workforce that this is going to play a role, and that shouldn't be ignored when it comes to our students, and that while we're concerned with some aspects, with us trying to know what extent they used it, it would be better for them to use it and use it correctly with our guidance than for them to avoid it and then be, you know, contributing to the digital divide and having negative consequences of not being able to use it. At least that's some of my takeaways, but I know that I think a little differently than others. So if anyone else has some last minute thoughts, we would love to hear them. We have about 2 minutes. All right, I guess it was all said.
Thank you to everybody in the audience. And Christala, thank you for facilitating such a great conversation today. I'm also going to go back to the state regents working group on ChatGPT and AI tools and make sure that we have a legal representative on there, because Michael, your perspective has been so helpful for us today, in addition to everybody else that shared here. Laura, thank you as well for even considering our own roles that we relate to, such as instructional design, because it's a game changer across the board. Thanks again, everybody.
Hey, we lawyers are going to need to work.
Clearly. Thank you all, though. We'll see you at 2 o'clock for the next sessions.